gas, yet you fed our families. And even as we feed our families, especially our God-given children, in this day and age when there is so much of different food and our children perhaps prefer the junk food, and parents also find it easier, less troublesome to give what they prefer than make a nutritious meal or find a nutritious meal. We pray that today's session would be one that enlightens our minds as parents, because Lord, we want to feed them with what is good for their bodies. So thank you for the parents who have joined. Thank you for Talavou's ministry in Sri Lanka and India, in terms of fitness, in terms of nutrition, and be with him as he speaks to us as parents today. But we ask this through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Over to you, Talavou.
Okay, Talavou, over to you. So you can share your screen. Any PTAs, could you, PTA members, could you please inbox me so that I can identify you? And then you can help me out when we break into the small rooms. Talavou, over to you. Great pleasure to have you.
Thank you very much. I hope everyone can see this. Is this visible?
Yes, yes.
It is. Okay, great. It's really exciting to speak to all of you, especially being a parent myself with three sons, one 8, 11, and 14, three boys. The subject of physical transformation, sports high performance, and fitness and exercise has been, you know, for the last 2.5 decades has been a very important topic for me. The past 15 years, I have been heavily involved with advising parents on how to maximize the growth of children and how to bring out the potential that they have as sportsmen with their physical attributes to be improved, and worked with many of them, and I've seen some very interesting results. I'll be sharing some of those examples. In the next 45 minutes, there's going to be a lot of information that I'll be sharing with you. A lot of things are going to be new. I'm going to approach this in a very different way. I'm going to try to make it as exciting as possible so that everybody is excited about nutrition and exercise and activity as much as I am. So please grab a pen, a paper, just follow through what I speak. I'm sure you're going to take a lot home today. So let me just move on. Today I would be covering a few topics. So first thing would be the understanding your child's structure and its dynamics. Very important for us to understand, the makeup of our physical bodies and why it behaves the way it behaves. If not, we will not be able to function with our bodies to be able to maximize and achieve the goals that we have. The second one is that understanding the child's physical attributes, what the child has been born with, the gifting from birth itself. How do we identify the child's physical attributes and the sports talent? What kind of sports do you think your child needs to enter? I'll be discussing in depth about that. General guidelines on the approach, how to encourage your child, how to engage your child, things that you need to keep in mind generally when you're dealing with kids in regards to food and activity. The next point would be maximizing growth of your child. This is a huge area that we neglect. We see this disadvantage in Sri Lanka overall. And there's a deficiency of particular nutrients that doesn't allow our children to grow. It's a lack of knowledge more than actual financial challenges. So we'll be talking about that in depth. And finally, the nutrition itself. How do you decide how much of what to give your child? So I'm hoping to cover all of this in the next 45 minutes. So it's a lot of information. I'll try to move as clearly as possible through each slide. To start with, I think we need to, if you can mute. Okay, so the body structure and its dynamics, the fundamentals, is what I would like to speak about. So let's start with the point of understanding our body, how complex and how it's important to understand how marvelous and how amazing our body is. If you look at just give me a second, I'm just having some problems with it. Okay, so if you just look at the amount of fat cells we have in the body, we have anywhere between 30 to 300 billion fat cells in this one body. That's what's where we store the extra calories that we eat. And there are storage compartments in our body that are called fat cells, and up to 300 billion we have of this. If you look at the army we have to fight infection, disease, we have about 500 billion white blood cells in our bodies. And if you look at the amount of transporters of nutrients, oxygen, we have red blood cells, about 30 trillion of them. And if you look at the amount of bacteria we have, and if you look at the total amount of cells we have in our body, we have 100 trillion cells in our body. And these are not dead cells. These are very alive. They're making decisions every split second. In our bodies, 100 trillion cells alive with a mandate. So we need to understand that we are dealing with a physical body that is extremely advanced and is able to figure out a lot of the challenges that we have daily. I mean, the number of decisions that we would personally make would be, you know, what time do we get up? What do we eat? You know, what do we wear? Where do we go? You know, 30, 100, 200, 500 decisions. What our body is making trillions of decisions every second, and it's managing all the infections that you have. You don't have to think about breathing, you're breathing. You don't think about your heart beating, it beats. So our bodies are amazing a creation that we have been blessed with. And if we don't understand how amazing and how complex this is, we will underestimate what needs to be done to be able to achieve the maximization of the potential of our children, or helping our children achieve their maximum capability. From the logic perspective of how the body works, one thing is clear, the way it thinks and it works. Within 6 months, 90% of our cells die and new cells are born. Pretty much 7 months ago, the body you have today, you didn't have it. This is only 7 months old. Every cell in our body dies and a new cell is born. So one of the primary objectives of the body is to create another you, and all the nutrients that goes into the body is to help create another child like your son, another son every 6 months. Whether that son is going to remain short or is going to remain tall or is going to be healthier or not healthy is going to depend on the last 6 months. What you've been feeding your child. So every cell dies and a new cell is born. Even though numerically our age is increasing, there is this transformation that continuously takes place. Every 6 months, we have most of our body being changed and new cells born. Another thing that really takes place, which is very, very much a pillar and foundational to our body, is that the primary objective of the body is to survive, is to live as long as it can. You don't have to tell the body to live, it will decide to live. If I tell you, let's go for a jog at the middle of the day at noontime, and I say, let's go and go for a jog, you know, most of us, we may be 100, 200 meters, 1 kilometer, and then we will stop running. But in the cool of the evening, if I said, let's go for a jog, you know, many of us might do, you know, a kilometer, even 2, maybe even 5 kilometers, depending on how fit we are. So what's the difference? Why at 12 noon this is going to happen, and why not at in the evening? So the reason is that the body's the temperature of the body, when it increases beyond, it goes to 99, 100 in the afternoon when you're jogging, and it goes to 101 because of the heat, your core temperature starts to increase. 101, 102, you are sweating, you are having headaches. And then you see, you know, the body knows that if it keeps going up like this at 110, it will die. And what it does is start to shunt the heat out of the body into the skin through sweating and other means, and starts reducing the amount of usage of oxygen to the muscles and starts to shut you down. So after you run about, a, you know, 500 meters to a kilometer in the under the sun at noontime, you will just shut down and you just stop because your body won't move until it cools down again. So the primary objective of the body is to live. It will change every decision of yours to make sure that it lives. And we need to understand this fundamental way it behaves. You have seen how weightlifters lifting weights, the way they shout, the way they scream, and then they go and they lift this heavy weight and they break the world record. This is because they emotionally drive themselves to a point where it tells the body, I must have this strength, otherwise I will die. That pushes you to the body to let and to give you the opportunity to lift something that you normally wouldn't do because you would hurt yourself. So this survival instinct that the body has will always be at play at the background of whether how we do our training or how we eat. It's always making a decision. What to do with nutrition, where to take this, do I use this, do I store it, do I let it circulate around the bloods? This is always at play. So this is a very important aspect to realize. Third pillar that is very important is that we have control of our genes. This is a very important aspect that we need to understand, because many of us feel that, okay, our parents had diabetes, was a heart patient, so therefore I'm also going to get it. You don't have to go down the same road if you change your lifestyle from what you were how your parents lived and what they ate and what their lifestyles were. Because what's governing our genes is an epigenome, which is like a software on top that we takes the information of the environment. And if you give it new information to that software called the epigenome, it will start to express different genes from our body, which will be different from our parents. So even though our parents were diabetics, we don't have to be diabetics. Even though our parents were heart patients, we don't have to be heart patients. If we change our lifestyle and our eating patterns and the way we do it differently to our parents, we are able to control this. In the same way, we are able to bring the best out of our children in regards to the nutrition and the activity we give them by the software receiving the information from what we are challenging, putting the body through, so that the best genes are expressed from the genome of the child, to make sure that we help build healthy kids who have a tremendous resistance to infection and also be able to do performances at a very high level in regards to sport or any activity. So the genes, also the genome, the epigenome helps us control genes, the way it expresses. So that too, we have a control of. So these three are very, very important for us to keep in mind when we are talking about food, when we are talking about activity for our children. The body needs to create another you. It needs every 6 months or 7 months, it creates another you. It's one of its primary objectives is to survive and live as long as it can. You don't have to tell your body to live long. It will live long as you give it the best conditions possible. It will do the rest. And then we control the expression of our genes by making sure that the software, the information that goes to the software, is always a positive information that helps you build your the child's physical structure. when you talk about physical attributes and sports talent, it's very important for us to recognize very early what the child's gifting is. Just because sometimes we are interested in cricket does not mean that every child is going to be a good cricketer or rugby or whatever that sport might be. So it's very important for you to look at your child and understand what kind of activity the child is going through. So there are typically about three types of physical bodies that I would like to speak about. The first one, how you identify it, is that they can eat anything, but they don't gain weight, but not gain weight. This is roughly what the child looks like. The child can eat whatever, but it does, but the child does not gain weight. Generally, even if you increase the quantity and you do that, the child will still remain kind of skinny. The reason being that the child is most probably a red muscle fiber dominant child. A red fiber muscle dominant child means the mitochondria, the furnace, the calorie burning furnace, the furnace that's within the body called the mitochondria, which takes the calories and then turns it to energy. The density of those furnaces are huge in number, are many. So whatever you feed the child, that those furnaces, the mitochondria burns the calories that come in. And so gaining weight is one of the abilities that the child would struggle with. The red muscle fibers, the characteristics of a red muscle fibers is that it's an endurance muscle fiber. It's a very, it's able to breathe, it's able to do endurance activities. And so the child's gifting, if you look at sport, would be on the lines of endurance-based sports, 5,000, long distance, running, anything that is endurance-driven, this child's gifting is that, because the body is a red fiber dominant body, is designed that way, doesn't gain weight easily. And that is one way of understanding how the gifting of your child, and moving the child towards more endurance sports would help bring the best out of the child. And the child will also enjoy that sport because your body is designed for that. You can't sprint, but you can run long distances or do a sport that demands more endurance from the child. And that's how you recognize a child that has more endurance than speed and power. The next group are children that even if they look at food, they gain weight. These children may eat the same amount of food that the other child that can eat anything and not gain weight. Both of them would eat the same amount of food, but one would end up looking like this and the other one won't. The reason why this child is just puts on weight, even if the child tries not to eat too much and just eats normal food and doesn't seem to be eating too much of anything, where the weight becomes a huge issue, it's because the child is blessed with these fibers called the white muscle fibers. White muscle fibers are very powerful, strong, explosive muscle fibers. But the problem that the fiber has is that it has very few mitochondria. So the furnaces this muscle fiber has is very few in number. So when this child eats even normal or tends to eat some extra food, the gain of weight is huge because the child is not able to burn it off that fast. The gifting of this child is towards strength, power, explosiveness, and therefore the mitochondria being low causes this problem of gaining weight. So in that way, you've got to watch their diet, you've got to think through their diet, and we'll talk about some of the ideas on how to help the child maintain a good healthy weight whilst being able to express their strength and their power and their speed they normally are able to. The third group, so this particular child's gifting is on the lines of power, strength, and speed. So 100 meters, their white fibers are a huge in number in their legs for sprinters. And that's why you know Bolt would have 95% white muscle fibers. You'll have great shot putters, discus throwers who would have both upper body and lower body, tremendous amount of white fibers. And the more white fibers dominant you are, the more weight you will tend to gain. And our children, you can identify well in advance. When children are gaining weight, generally it is clear that the white fiber aspect is very dominant. And that's why the child is having a calorie burning a challenge. From that, you know the child's gifting is into speed, into power, and putting the child towards those sports are very important. Third group is mismanaging their eating. If you mismanage their eating, they gain weight. And the reason being that some of there's a mix of muscles between red 50% maybe and 50% of white, or it could be 60-40. It's kind of a middle. A child that has both muscle fibers, able to burn the fat at sometimes, but also unable to burn because of the white fibers they have. So they have a mix, and this percentage, it's a combination of both fibers existing in the child. And if the child eats wrong and eats too much, he gains weight. But if he's able to stop eating and he manages his eating, then suddenly you see the child losing weight and then not having a weight problem. These children are usually very good at team sports and middle distance events. And this is where we need to move our children towards team sports. If they have this kind of behavior, or these are the attributes, and this is the way the child gains weight. Doesn't become extremely heavy and doesn't become extremely thin. But if the food is given right, the child's weight seems to be very normal. So excellent talent would be into lots of the sports game, basketball, cricket, rugby. These are the sports that they can get into. And in the track and field, in the middle distances, they would have great talent and they'll really be able to succeed. General guidelines, if you were to look at how to approach, encourage, and engage your children, from a family nutrition perspective, we need to not label food as good versus bad. Please do not tell your children that this is good or this is bad. The way to address it is to approach it from a perspective that we teach our children to appreciate how food really helps our body and how food really helps strengthen and provide the nutrition that is required for our body. And we need to keep in mind also to keep teaching our body, our children from a health perspective, how the food helps, rather than saying that this is a bad or this is a good food. So we need to get that, the thinking right. It is normal for children to want junk food, but it's also normal for children to have to think about good food also. So we need to teach our children what is good food and help them enjoy good food as well, and make it interesting, make it tasty for them, give it to them in the way that they like to eat. Some of the fears that we have as adults, we don't have to fear about them having those problems. Because their metabolic rate or their ability to burn calories, it's at the highest level. Till about age 20, 20 plus, you burn whatever you eat, the amount of activity they do, they're able to handle a lot of calories. So some of the fears we have as adults, we need to not worry about our children. But we need to teach our children what is good food, why it's good. And we need to kind of teach them to also enjoy good food by making sure we prepare it properly. So we need to balance between the foods that they will take. Sometimes it will be junk food that they are, you know, too happy about. But then also we need to make sure that we are teaching them what is good and what is valuable in regards to food. Active children can have trouble being getting adequate calories if parents strictly limit treats. We need to be careful because sometimes children don't eat. They don't have time to eat. The interval time they don't eat anything. They come home. They have not eaten the whole day. And so you got to mix it up. As much as we want to give a well balanced and a plate of rice and food that we believe is balanced, we need to also make sure that the calories keep coming in. And some of these times those calories will have to be in the form of treats, that is okay. It's fine. It's okay for them. Even though for us, we would not do it because they can handle it. When you're looking at treats, you know, peanut butter with crackers or muffins or cereal with milk, using fruits, having some juices for them, sandwiches, you know, make it interesting. Give it in a way that they would love to eat. This is very important. When we're looking at what they need to eat. Also avoid giving candy bars, cookies, chips, These are the things that you want to avoid from giving them. If you give them peanut butter with crackers, or if you give them a good sandwich or a nice juice, they will not want to have chocolates and cookies and that kind of stuff, which is not going to be good for their health. So we need to kind of balance it. And even if they have it on and off, we should not be getting on their case on it immediately, but try to discuss food from a very healthy perspective. Then when you're looking at children who are growing, their bodies are growing, their shapes are changing. It's very important that we express, our concerns of the child, not based on their looks, but, from their health perspective. If they're getting overweight because they're eating wrong, and it's good to talk to them and say, listen, son, this is not going to work for you. This is not good for your health. There's lots of challenges that happen later on. If you keep eating like this is not the type of food that's long-term viable for you, that helps you. And talk to the child about what you see visually, the transformation, the unnecessary weight that's coming on, and help the child from a health perspective. Talk to the child from a health perspective rather than you're saying you're looking fat, you're looking ugly, you're looking too thin, please don't bring those out. Because if we bring those things out, we are going to start to have huge problems in the future with our children. We are going to convey the wrong message that you are not good enough because you're fat, you're not good enough because you're too skinny. And this is the wrong message. We don't want them to have this going into the future. And they will have other challenges in the future if they keep thinking that they are not good enough because they look a certain way. We need to address it from the way of health. Son, this is not good. This is the better food to eat. This, when you hit this, you grow taller. When you take this, you will become stronger. And speak to them very positive messages of how it will help them transform their bodies. So when we are addressing it, make sure that we are not talking about the size of the children. And make them always feel that they're loved and cared. And I think I've touched about that a bit. If we keep pushing the children and keep telling them that they're fat, or if they have a weight problem, then we are going to have unhealthy eating habits. There's going to be a lot of frustration, a lot of guilt. They'll be getting angry about the way they look. They will hate the way they look. And that is not what we want to have from the children. We want to help them through that. The way they look, they feel. Sometimes, it's not because of their behavior. It's not because that they ate wrong. Sometimes they're born so dominant as a white muscle fiber where the mitochondria is not sufficient to burn every calorie. Then we have to be wise the way we feed our children and make our children be able to achieve a healthy weight. Heat is something that we need to also be very conscious when our children are running around. Their ability to sweat is not as great as adults. So their core temperature starts to rise very fast. They get dehydrated quite quickly. And we need to watch that when they're involved in activity. When children start to sweat too much, we got to understand that whatever activity they do, they should be breaking a sweat. They should be having some sweat taking place. But if it's a huge amount of sweat that is taking place in the activity, it is beginning to affect the activity itself. So sweating is the mechanism of the body to cool itself. And it's putting water on the skin to cool the body, to make sure that the temperature comes down. And if your body is spending time to cool the body, then we are going to have an issue where the child's ability to continue doing the activity is going to get lesser and lesser. And if it's a sport, the child will not be able to perform at its best. So maintaining, always giving beverages that help the child cool, remain at the closest to normal temperature is very important. Encourage drinking beverages that they like to drink. If they're heavily involved in an activity that is sweating, it could be a sweet kind of drink, but with some salt in it. That is one way of helping the child through it. If it's extremely humid day and you see the child under tremendously hot conditions and humid conditions, then 10 to 20 minutes, we need to stop, give them something to drink, and let them continue their game. So we need to watch the heat part of children, especially when we are watching them on the grounds and how they are performing. Going on to growth, we need to look at how the children really maximize growth. We have seen children with their parents when they are 5 years old leave this country and they go to Europe, America, Australia, and you know, 20 years later, you see those boys. I don't think you can find a Sri Lankan boy who is less than 6 feet, who is outside Sri Lanka, who have gone when they were young, around 5, 6, 7 years old. They have gone to those countries and they have eaten in a particular way that has brought, has maximized their growth potential. The same child who is 6'3 today in Europe or in the US or Australia, if that child was in Sri Lanka, would not be taller than, you know, 5'8, 5'10, 5'11. But you see them, you know, 6'1, 6'3, 6'4 sometimes. It would be very difficult to find a child, a boy, 20 years later that is actually less than 6 feet because of the type of food they have been eating. So the Sri Lankan genetic structure, the potential has for children to grow over 6 feet. And I believe that this potential can of reaching 6 feet can be achieved by age of 16. I think by the age of 16, Sri Lankans can hit the six foot mark. And by the time they're done with their growth at 18, 19, 20, 21, it will be 6'2", 6'3", somewhere there. It's important, therefore, to look at the way we eat, the way we feed our children from this age itself. And that's what excites me about speaking to all of you, because your children are still from grade 1 to grade 5, most of you. And hitting the growth spurt is when they enter their teens. But if nutrition is given systematically from now onwards, your child will easily, a boy will easily be 6 feet by the age of 16, very comfortably, if we work on it now. And I'm very excited to speak to you about this and show you what you need to do to help your child achieve its their maximum height that they genetically they are able to. There are only three reasons why you don't grow tall. The first reason is dwarfism. Dwarfism, when you look at the child, you know that there's a problem in the length of the legs, the arms, and the number of dwarfism that a person can get is less than 0.1, it's 0.01% a chance of having a child who has that at the top end. So we understand that if this exists, then you can't grow tall, but it's a very, very, very small percentage of people that that are born that way. The second reason for the child not to grow are growth hormonal deficiencies. And again, only 0.01% to 0.03%, not even 0.5% of children have this problem, which means that most children don't have a problem with growth hormone problems. But there are some children, and very rarely that these children exist, who have a growth hormonal problem. But these two endocrinologists can help discover whether there is a hormonal problem or not, and accordingly provide the medication that is needed for the child to have normal growth again. So there is a solution for these children also. But the percentage of these children, of any child having a growth hormone problem is very, very small. But 99.9% of the problem that we have is lack of nutrition. Lack of nutrition is the biggest problem that's affecting growth. You know, Sri Lankan diet research has shown that we are 50% deficient on the most important nutrient for growth, and that is protein foods, which I would like to speak about. When you look at Japan, in the 1960s, 1970s, they had a policy change on how children should be fed. And today, the average height of the Japanese have grown for more than 6 inches on average. The nation's height has increased because they made a policy to change how children are fed from the 1960s, 1970s onwards. So nutrition is the biggest reason why our children are not growing. And in the Sri Lankan diet lifestyle, this is a huge issue. It is not a financial issue. It's the way we choose the food. This evening, I would like to really unpack that for you and to help you understand this better. When you're looking at nutrition, there are about 42 nutrients in food that is very important. But there are two macronutrients that we must be very conscious about. The first one are carbohydrates. Carbohydrates are the petrol to move our body from one place to the other. And the protein is what builds structure and helps our bodies. Whatever we touch, whatever we can feel, all is made out of protein or made out of protein. So the petrol is the carbohydrates that moves this body, and the structure that we have is made out of proteins. These two are very different nutrients, and they do two different things to our bodies. I have seen parents, pushing food down their children, saying, "You're not going to grow if you don't eat this." And they're putting in petrol and petrol and petrol. They're putting in the rice, the bread, and they're forcing the child to eat. No, you don't get, you'll grow this way rather than this way. So building structure is always protein, what we can touch. So when you look at the types of foods that exist, all breads, rice, vegetables, string hoppers, kottu, pittu, hoppers, all those are carbohydrates. That's all on the petrol side. If you look on the protein side, the food is the beef, the chicken, the fish, the eggs, seafood, mutton, everything on that side. There are vegetables, proteins also that exist. But when it comes to growth, when it's coming to make sure that your child grows, I like to focus a lot on the animal proteins that are available, because the more protein we are able to give our child, the more we can measure it and give it, the better for us to make sure that our children are growing. So these are the two nutrients that we must be always conscious about. Now, when protein comes in the body, when the body receives the protein, the body has to prioritize how the protein is being used. So the first protein that comes to our child's body is first used to create another child. The same, in 6 months, the whole body, all the cells die and new cells are born. So the primary objective of the body is to create another body like that. Your child needs to create another similar body. And so the first part of the protein that the child eats will go towards that. The second part, if there is enough, then it goes into patching up the micro tears. When the child starts to do sports, starts to run around, starts to do different types of activities, the pressure that is placed on the body creates little micro tears and little bleeding taking place on those muscles which have been challenged by the sport. And the body wants to quickly seal it off and make sure that it doesn't tear again. And every time it patches up, the muscle is getting stronger, it's becoming bigger. So the body is remodeled to make sure that it adapts to the training and exercise the child goes through. That's why you could look at a child from a distance and say, look at an athlete and say, "Hey, he's a swimmer. He looks like a swimmer. Why does he look like a swimmer? Because he has, his shoulders are broad. You can see like a V shape in his body. Because whilst going through the water, the muscles have developed and body has remodeled itself, adjusted to the stress to make sure it looks like that. So there is a rugby body, there is a fast bowler's body, there is a basketball body, that because under the certain stress that body's put, the body starts to strengthen those areas that need to, that are required for that sport. And so the body takes the protein that comes in, first part of it goes to rebuild another you, then the next part goes into patching up all of this. Now, if there is enough of patching up and there's enough protein to be able to patch up all the running around that the child is going through, then the next protein will go towards growth to help the child grow. Now, that's when the child starts to grow. But the first two steps will first be fulfilled with the protein before it goes to the third step. Now, if you don't have enough protein in the body, then it could stop here. It doesn't go to growth. I have met many children who have grown 13, 14, 15, and suddenly they stop growing at 15. And when you discuss with the parents what happened, it is clear that they had stopped. They had begun some sport 2 years ago, and the nutrition was the same level. The protein was the same amount, and then it stops there. Now, if you don't have enough protein even for the patching up, then the child will start getting injuries, and there'll be a lot of damage that takes place. The idea is that to give enough protein for the child to do all these three, it will create another you, it will patch up all the challenges that it has, and then it will go for growth. We need to make sure the child is growing all the time. And that is what I want to discuss with you. Just a quick example. These are two parents. The mother is 4'11", father is 5'2". They had two sons, and I was involved in the son was 12 years old, ran 100 meters in 12.2 seconds or something like that. And I remember when the child was only 12 years old, was running that fast, and I was very excited to see this child be able to grow and be the first 9.99 for Sri Lanka. So I sponsored the child. I sponsored the child when he was about age 13, and I gave all the food, the protein that was required, from the types of food that was required. So I handled the diet, and I gave this guy, this child, the food. But then what I suddenly realized is that the 10-year-old brother was also eating the food, because economically the family was disadvantaged. So you had the 10-year-old also eating the food. So I had to kind of sponsor both children to make sure that my 13-year-old champion athlete that I was looking at would also be fed. So we sponsored this, I sponsored this child, and we gradually saw this child start to really grow very fast. Father 5'2", mother 4'11". You could see by the child, by the time the child was about 15 years old, the child had become 5'6", and hitting 5'7". But what was interesting was the 10-year-old son, by the time he hit 13, was about 5'6". And by the time the child became under 14, he became the Sri Lanka's, you know, one of the best athletes that started coming out from that age group. Purely by changing the diet, this particular, their son, the second son, today is 5'11", about 20 years old. Father 5'2", mother 4'11", and the son is close to 6 feet tall. So what is very clear is that when the nutrition is given and the protein is given, that irrespective of what the height you presently have, your children can still grow to that maximum. Today, Asiri is one of the best sprinters in the country. He broke the under 14 record, under 16 record in the 100 meters. About 3 years ago, when he was about 17, 18 years old, he clocked a 10.74 in the 100 meters. And that's him running in front, doing the nationals, Sri Lanka nationals. Because of his height, the father, mother being short, but the child being tall. See, most of the time we are thinking, okay, because I'm short, my child will be short. That person is tall, so therefore their sons will be tall. It's normal. It's a genetic. It's not a genetic reason. There is no genetic reason to stop us from growing. It is a nutritional issue, and the Sri Lankan genetic structure is allowing our children to grow very tall. So we don't have a genetic problem. We have a food problem. And as soon as we fix the food problem, we see the children being able to grow rapidly. And that's what we have seen in Asiri's, his growth that has taken place. This particular growth chart is available online, 2 to 20 years of boys. If you just search it, you will find this growth chart. And what I would like to show is that, you know, how you, based on the age and the weight, you need to peg your child's weight and height on a chart like this and monitor that the child needs to be in the range of 90% on the 100th percentile. So you've got to be above all of this. You need the child's weight to go up, and you want the height also to go up. So the best way to track your child is to tabulate your child on a graph like this. And you can track your child systematically going forward in regards to what the child's height will be. The best way to do it is to maintain a chart like this for your child and see your child grow. And from that, we will be able to understand how the child's height will take place. You know, talking about the nutrition issue, I'll finish in 5 minutes, but we'll talk about the nutrition part of it. As I spoke about, the macronutrients that they are very concerned about are the carbohydrates and the protein. When it comes to the carbohydrates, Sri Lankans have no problems in the amount of carbohydrates we take. We love our carbs and we just eat a lot of it. The main thing is on the carbohydrate side, we need to keep it brown, we need to keep it red, we need to keep it vegetables as much as possible. So this is something that we need to keep in mind. But the area where I want to focus is on the protein part of the child. What is required? Earlier, we had a food pyramid that we were told to go by, and this was what we were, what was taught to us. But as of late, that has been thrown out, and now it talks about the plate. So when you look at your plate of food, it means the vegetables need to be, you know, as much or even more than the grains. The amount of fruit you eat will be similar to your vegetables and proteins. And this is roughly what your plate must look like. Your child's plate must look like this. It can't be 75% of it grains and some vegetables on the side and some piece of meat on the side and a piece of fruit on the side. That doesn't work that way. The healthy way for your child is to look at a diet on these lines. And when you visually look at the plate of food your child is given, please keep this in mind so that the child gets all the nutrients that the child needs. The child doesn't need the way the carbohydrates were spoken about earlier. Now with vegetables, we need to really bring about and dominate the plate as much as possible with vegetables. This is a very important chart that I really want to share with you. Is that from the age of 5 to 10, which is the age group that today our parents are with me on this. And if you look at 11 to 15, you're looking at 1.5 grams of protein and 1 gram of protein for growth purposes. And this is the potential height that the child must have. And every 4 months, roughly what the height run rate must be for your child. You need to take your child, place him against the wall, place a hardcover book on top of his head, mark it, put the date. You don't put the date, put the age and the months. So say, 8 years and 3 months, and then put a mark there. Then every 4 months, you keep marking the wall, and then you try to see whether the minimum height that is spoken here has been achieved by your child. Now, like I said, the first part of the protein will go towards creating another child, another you. Then the second part goes for the catching up. Then it's the third part that helps you to go for growth. Now, we got to make sure that watching the growth, you can clearly say that there was enough protein coming into the body to create another you, to catch up whatever activity is doing, and also the growth is happening. Then you know that the child is getting the right amount of protein. From that, you can clearly understand it. But arithmetically, we also need to calculate it. We need to calculate how much protein your child needs. From 5 to 10, it's 1 gram. Then if the child is 30 kilos, it's 30 grams of protein. If the child is 40 kilos, then it's 40 grams of protein. As the child gets bigger, more active into sports, if the child is physically getting bigger and all that, then you're looking at 1.5 grams of protein, which is 45 grams if it's 30 kilos, 60 grams if it's 40 kilos. And then you can see what the annual potential growth of the child is that you must have. So watching that growth every 4 months is very, very important. If the growth is not taking place, most probably the amount of protein the child is getting is insufficient and not enough, and you need to increase it. The measurements that are given here helps you calculate arithmetically what exactly your child needs to get based on the weight. So the weight multiplied by 1 gram up to about 10 years, weight multiplied by 1.5 grams from 11 to 15. And if the child is involved in sports, then you have to calculate it by 2 grams per kilogram of body weight. So if you're looking at the protein chart and you're trying to figure out, okay, how do I give the protein? Whole egg has 6 grams of protein. Egg white has 3 grams. On average, beef, chicken, fish cooked without the bone, 100 grams would be about 25%. So 25 grams would be protein. That would be a good way of calculating the amount of protein that comes from the beef, chicken, and fish. If it's milk, a glass of milk will have only about 3.5 grams. If it's milk powder, 100 grams, it'll only give you 11 grams of protein. Soya beans, lentils, rice gives those char, gives that, but you need to calculate the calculation that we spoke earlier of what it should look like for your child in regards to the protein requirement. If it's 30 grams or 45 grams, look at it from the blue and the purple section and do the calculation from there. Let the soya beans, lentils, and all of that be a bonus. Let the vegetable part be a bonus, unless you are vegetarian, and then you need to really dig deep to understand how do I give the same amount of protein per day from a vegetable perspective. A quick way of doing this, let's say 30 grams, 30 kilo child, 1.5 grams of protein required. What you do is you take breakfast, lunch, you break it up like that, you put them 15 grams on each slot. So you spread it through the day. Let's say one egg, and then the balance is breakfast, one egg, and then there's 9 grams remaining. Then you're looking at about 60 grams of chicken will be about 10 grams. It will be about 15 grams. There's a typo error there. You will see there again typo error, but that should be 15 there, so it will be zero. And the nine grams that is remaining from the breakfast, you can give a chicken sandwich. That would be about 40 grams of chicken sandwich would make a balance of zero there. So this is the way you would chart. You would chart your you would break up the diet on how you would give the child. You'd mark the height and the weight on the wall, minimum 1 centimeter, 1.5 centimeters every 4 months. The growth must take place annually, about 6 centimeters must take place. But then every 4 months you recalculate the amount of protein that is required. The child's weight starting off, even if it's 30 grams, might 30 kilos could be 35 kilos very quickly. Then when you multiply it by 1.5, you get a substantial increase that you need to account for it when you are making the food chart for the child. So based on the above chart that I've shown you, take those foods and then plug it in to the child's diet on how the child needs to be able to get the proteins that is needed. My calculation on the lunch, which is 10 grams, is incorrect. It should be 15. My calculation on the dinner, 60 grams fish, is not 30, it is 15. That's how the balance became zero there. And then you can give a chicken sandwich in the middle to be able to catch up on the protein. And that's how you would give the children their diet. So that's pretty much what I would like to leave with you at this moment. I know it's a lot of information that I just discussed and shared with you. Now I'm open for any kind of questions that you may have on what we have discussed.
Okay, Talavou, what we will do now is we will break into small breakout rooms, and we will get the scribes to jot down the questions, and we will throw it at you. So you need not go into any breakout room. You stay in the main room. Don't click on the join group, join room. Let the others go in. So parents, I will be breaking you all into 4 rooms. Please go into those rooms, breakout rooms, and it will come join room. Click on that, and we will have scribes there who will jot down the questions that you have, and then we will come back in about 3 to 4 minutes to table the questions to Talavou. Okay? Thank you. So please join the rooms that are allocated to you. Please join the rooms. Please click on join room. Please click on join room. Yes, that's right. Few more still remaining in the main room. If you can click on join room. Please click on join room. And about another 8 of you, if you can click on join room.
please click on join room. Another four of you, if you can click on join room and table your questions to the moderator there. Hi, Dilsha, can you help me a bit here? Dilsha? Hi,
Dilsha. Hello.
Unmuted you. If you can just
yes.
take questions that this room might have, and if you can table it to me at the when we have the main room session, please. Just ask.
You mean the whatever the question we have, right?
Yeah, whatever question you have pertaining to our topic, I will unmute now, and you can ask the questions.
Actually, I have no question to ask, but the thing is, it was so clear to me, and I learned a lot. But the only thing is, what I wanted to ask him was, now in my house, normally I don't bring any beef. I know, but is there any supplement for that food, that vitamin which we are getting from beef?
Okay, what you can do is you can ask that from him. Okay, we'll ask that from him. So I will open
okay.
it. Okay.
Okay.
It's hard, but it's possible. But we'll ask. We'll ask because he's the expert, right? We'll ask that question. Yeah.
So if you all have any questions, table it. I'll just give another 1 minute, and then we will go into the main room. Amal, you.
Sure. We, right? Yeah, we already got two questions. So yeah.
Good. Okay. Excellent. Excellent.
Any other questions? If you have, as it was informed, we have about another 40 seconds. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I think it's time for us to leave unless, yeah.
Okay, I think everybody has come in. Some people have just gone off. So may I have Asirini, if you can table your question, what have you got in your group?
No, Pastor Kandor. I didn't have any questions from my group of parents.
Roshan, any questions in your group? Roshan? Roshan, you need to
unmute. Hi, Kandor. Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, sorry, I have the mic off, sorry. There was that this talk we put on the website, so I believe it will come on the PTA website in a day or two as we have done with the others. Right?
Yeah, the recording will come on.
Right, then two questions to Talavou from our group.
I'll use my notes.
In terms of recommending food especially vegetables and fruit to children, which is sometimes hard to, you know, get them to have, which particular fruits and vegetables, Talavou, would you recommend?
When it comes to fruits and vegetables, I wouldn't worry about which one it is. The vitamins and minerals are all available in the food that we take, and vegetables are an excellent source of nutrients, and also the fruits. Whatever fruit you choose, whatever vegetable you choose, will definitely help. Only thing when it comes to vegetables, the leafy side of vegetables would be ideal rather than the potatoes and the starchy side of the vegetables. That part of it, we need to watch if that is consumed heavily. But the idea is to make it interesting, make it exciting when it comes to vegetables. Just put a dressing that the person will like, the child will like, taste the dressing and then have it, make it interesting. Mix up the vegetables with maybe eggs, maybe some meat with it. Mix it up, make it tasty. Discover what your child would like to have. Don't worry about some of the oils and the fats that we bother about as adults. Main thing what we need is to make it attractive and consumable to be able to consume by the children. Fruits, any fruit, whatever the fruits that are available, what the child likes, try to introduce it in a way that the person, that the child would like to consume. So we don't have to split hairs about what exactly in the fruit side that we would like to do. The vegetable side is definitely towards the leafy side would be the best. The kangkungs and the salad leaves and the you know, the red pepper, the green peppers, the tomatoes, you know, you can bring all that in. And the potato side of it and things like that we can reduce, especially if the child has a weight problem. If the child has no weight problem, I wouldn't even bother about that. Go ahead, let the child eat whatever the child is interested in. But the main thing is make it interesting, give it a variety, change it every day, and try to discover your child's taste and bring that in to your diet.
Okay, just one more question, Talavou. By the way, I was thinking you'll make a good chef, but on a more serious note, the other question was, this lady, her son does a number of sports, but she notices that her son doesn't have a particular time for his food. Like he may take his breakfast instead of eating it in the morning and then eat it during the interval. So the question is, would you suggest that a child should have particular time frames when meals are taken in?
Yes, it's very important. The biggest mistake you can do in nutrition is not to have breakfast. Breakfast is the most important meal of the day. You've got to get that food in. If it means that the child has to get up a little bit early to eat, then we need to do that. But if it's training, early morning training, then you can't train with a full stomach. You have to, the stomach must be empty because you don't want the blood concentrated only in the stomach for digestion. And there's not enough blood going to the limbs. When you do any sport or any exercise, your stomach must be empty to make sure the blood is concentrated on the arms and the legs so that the child can actually do the training. If we have a meal that takes 2 to 3 hours to digest or even 4 to 5 hours, if you drink too much of water during that particular meal, it can take as much as 5 to 6 hours to digest. So if you're going to have a substantial meal, it is important to, the max time you have is about 2 hours. Up to about 2 hours, you can take it. But in that particular meal, you would sip water and then you would consume the meal. So if the child can't, I mean, especially in the morning, if it's 5 o'clock training, then you can't, you know, have that kind of meal. Then you would have like a banana, a sandwich, you can have a sandwich and a banana kind of slice of bread or two before training. But immediately after training, the child must have the protein that is required because that's the time the body really needs its protein. And we need to make sure that the protein and the carbohydrates come immediately after the training. If there's one time you could really have anything white, white bread is to have it immediately after training, because you want the glucose, you want the nutrients to enter the bloodstream very quickly. and you want the blood sugar levels to increase. So you, helping having the white slice of bread after training with a protein, chicken or fish or whatever, sandwich or something like that would be excellent. So you need to balance it that way. Lunchtime before training, again, 2 hours before you go to eat, when you're eating it, have a little bit of water. And then after you digest, you can increase the amount of water. Otherwise, the water will dilute the digestive juices that are needed to break down the food in the stomach. And the digestion process takes too long. Whichever way, when the child goes for training, the stomach must be empty. And at the other times, we need to manage the eating and control it by the amount of water the child will consume. But you've got to make sure that you have specific times that you feed the child, especially after the training. Make sure you have fed the child. Make sure those protein intakes comes into the diet. If the child is very exhausted after every training, your child should never be exhausted after training. After training, your child must feel like, I can train another session. Then the nutrition is right. If your child is utterly exhausted, the amount of the petrol that the child needed has not been in the body, and that's why the child feels so exhausted. So after every training session, if the child feels fit and feels like, okay, I can go on training, I'm fit, then you can say that the nutrition, the child entered the training was balanced and it was right. The child feels exhausted. That means the amount of petrol that was required, the carbohydrates that were needed were not given, and the child you need to look at the child's diet in regards to how the child feels. That's the way you need to look at it.
Thank you. Any question? I think, Roshan, you had two. That's all, right?
Yes, that's it.
Yeah. Okay. May I go to Dilsha? Dilsha, if you have, you had a couple of questions in your room.
Hello.
Yes, Dilsha, go on.
No, what I had was now, even in my child, he doesn't like to eat any meat or fish. So when I want to feed him, like, even mutton, I blend it and put it in the soup and feed. So even if he sees any fish, he doesn't like to eat. So what I'm asking is, if I can't feed him like beef and mutton, any other supplements which I can take, like from any vegetables? But I'm giving him about 2 eggs per day that he eats.
Okay. I think that's a very good question. I mean, even if the child can't have the meats, the fish, I wouldn't worry too much about it, because eggs are the best protein that is out there. The protein that is embedded in eggs, our bodies absorb very quickly and is able to absorb the protein that's within the bioavailability of the nutrient in the egg. Our bodies are able to absorb it. So what I would say is that you increase the number of eggs. Yes. Because eggs is no more an issue. Cholesterol, that has been thrown off. The FDA US has thrown out that, you know, that food cholesterol can affect serum cholesterol. Serum cholesterol, the cholesterol levels in our body is affected by the body itself. And it's not food that affects it. They have said you can have any amount of eggs. Eggs is not a problem anymore. And you can let your child eat the number of eggs that the child would like to eat. I mean, my son would have 5 eggs a day at one sitting for breakfast. And then he would have some eggs in the night also, in the evening if he wants to. So eggs is an excellent protein. And I know kids sometimes prefer eggs than anything else. And that's a fantastic protein. You shouldn't be looking at maybe, using eggs as an excellent source of protein to be able to do that.
Right, thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Amal from your group?
Yeah, we had 2 questions and most of the parents were very appreciative of the presentation with the information. The first question was about the fact that kids are at home at the moment, unable to go for training or any sports activities. Would you be able to recommend a kind of a small regiment of training that based on their ages, what they could do at home type of thing, because they can't even go to a gym or sometimes even outside? Would there be? I actually asked the parent whether he was engaged in the activity PT activities that are recommended by the school in the evenings. He said no, he was not doing that. But would you be able to recommend something like that? Is it clear?
Yes. I mean, I understand the question. I mean, there are a lot of free body exercises that you can do. There are a lot of jumps that can be done in one place. There are pull-ups, push-ups you can do. Anything that increases your heart rate, whatever ups the heart rate, is the way to go. So you can run on the spot. You can do jumps. You can step and kneel and step and kneel and kind of move forward. Lunges, doing things like lunges. Whatever the child can do that would increase the heart rate, bring it to the place of panting, where the child starts to pant, would be an excellent way of monitoring that exercise. And if the child can make a conversation while panting, that intensity would be great. If it's getting to the point where the child can't make a conversation while doing the activity, then the intensity has gone quite high, and therefore you need to just regulate it and bring down the activity. So you need to be creative with what you have, the space you have, and do anything that increases, you know, the stomachs, the dips, the pull-ups, the push-ups, the lunges, walking lunges, dips, squatting and jumping up. There are so many a variety of exercises. If you just search the internet of exercises you can do at home, you'd find a lot of it. But the main thing is to do it to the point where the child can make a conversation rather than getting to the point where he can't make a conversation because the activity is too intense. That's when the heart rate goes beyond the training zone. And you kind of need to monitor that, especially at this age.
Would there be a minimum amount of time or maximum amount of time that they should be engaged in?
Yes. I mean, it depends. I mean, if the child is panting a lot during that activity, then you're talking about even 15, 20 minutes is more than enough. But if it's like an interval training where the child is panting for a while, then taking a small break, again doing it, then about 45 minutes activity would be great. But if it's a continuous activity that is continuously making the child hyperventilate to a certain extent, then 20 minutes itself should be sufficient. So when the intensity increases, then the exercise benefit increases. So you can pull that from a time period wise, or you can shorten it by increasing the intensity.
Okay, the second question was about being vegetarian, and the parent was asking whether it is possible to still fulfill the protein requirement.
Of course, you can do that. I mean, vegetables has been something that's been highlighted a lot these days. That the benefits of vegetables are only now we have begun to discover. Things that we had understood 20 years ago, 10, 20 years ago, were very different than it is today. The nutrients that are available in vegetables and the protein available in the body, it's very clear that there's a lot to now receive from vegetables. Again, if you search the vegetables in the internet and you search for protein, high protein concentrated foods, vegetables, you would be able to understand what kind of proteins you need to take in regards to the vegetable side of it. You can achieve it as long as you consciously, purposely make that effort to give the child. Because when you want our child to grow, especially in Sri Lanka, where our eating habits are not norm. I mean, we under-eat the amount of protein we need. The consumption pattern is such that unless we consciously make sure we are achieving that amount of protein every day for the child, the genetic potential of the child will not be achieved. But if the child was in Europe or America or in Australia, just the eating lifestyle itself really helps the child be able to grow. I was dealing with some South African coaches who came from South Africa for the Rugby Football Union, and they called me in to coordinate with them in regards to their training. And after the meeting, we sat to have some food, and three chicken fried rice packs were put in front of us for lunch. So the South African coaches look at me and say, you know, Talavou, what is this? I said, this is chicken fried rice. And then they open the packs and they look at me and they smile. And I said, why are you smiling? They said, where is the chicken? So I said, it's mixed with the rice. And then they looked at me and they laughed again. And they said, you know what, in my country, if you said chicken fried rice, you have to look for the rice. There's so much of chicken. And that is exactly the way that they would be eating in those countries compared to us. But their natural diet is too much of protein. They get fat. They put on weight in those countries because of too much of protein, that then there's fat food in it. Sri Lankans get put on weight because of too much carbohydrates, too much energy. So we need to look at the foods that are available, especially vegetarians, and really dig into it. But make sure that you on purpose achieve the calculation. If it's 30 grams of protein, 45 grams, 50 grams, 60 grams of protein, you must make sure that that child gets that amount. When the child gets that amount of protein, then the child can create another body like the child has, can patch up all the tears that are happening, and then it goes to growth. So the barometer of really watching whether your child is getting enough protein or not, whether you're a vegetarian or you're being able to eat animal proteins, is whether the child is having this run rate of growth. And if the run rate of growth is taking place, then you can automatically assume that there's enough protein for the child to go through phase one, phase two, and now is in phase three. If the child is not growing, then it is clear that the amount of protein the child is receiving is not adequate to grow, and maybe not even adequate to patch up the micro tears that are taking place in the body. And therefore, a child could get injuries and whatever from the sport that the child does. So the best indicator would be measure the child against the wall, see the growth every 4 months, measure it. From there, you will know how much more protein must I give my child and how much more food must I give the child. But whatever time we are giving the food, just make sure that the food is interesting, they like it. Don't force them to eat it in a particular way. If they like it in a particular way, they like it fried, they like it in a particular way, bring it out. You know, use it sometimes, just, you know, coconut oil is excellent to fry with. I mean, it's healthy. So there are things that we are afraid of that we should not be afraid of for children. Children are able to handle a lot more than what we can handle.
Yeah, that's all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Talavou, thank you. Excellent presentation, excellent explanation to our parents. And I'm sure it'll be a real benefit to them. So Asirini, may I invite you to give the vote of thanks?
On behalf of the PTA of STC, Mr. Talavou Alailima, I don't know whether I pronounce your surname correctly.
No, that's fine.
Actually, today, what we learned from you, especially with your real life examples, is excellent. Information, facts, and the tips given by you to all our parents, excellent, Mr. Talavou, because I think we got to know how we need to give food to our children, especially in their behind all the fast foods that is available. We got an idea how we need to feed our children. Thank you very much for being a part of our webinars, and we really appreciate the time spent with us. Thank you very much, and may God bless you.
Thank you very much.